Kayla's in the building.
Valley, happy Valentine's Day. I'm Carly Bernberg.
And I'm Julie Ricciardi. Welcome back to The V.
We have a great show planned for you today.
This episode, you may notice we decided to switch things up.
We thought The V deserved a mini makeover.
We wanted you, the students, to be more involved in our production. But don't worry, school, community, sports, and Man on the Street are here to stay.
But stay tuned for new challenges, unique live performances, and features that you really can relate to.
We even managed to get some teacher cameos.
But first, Julia will uncover the students' opinions on SDA.
Student Dance Association, better known as SDA, has been one of Wayne Valley's longest-running and loudest traditions. Every year, two student leaders called overalls oversee the blue and white teams. With eight captains by each of their sides, they're ready to create four dances: tap, palm, aerobics, and jazz, complete with creative costumes and realistic props. From over 200 girls screaming at 6 a.m. on the infamous SDA Monday to hallways decked out in blue and white, it's hard to miss the start of SDA week. It's obvious that the people involved are really passionate about it. The sense of teamwork and pride for their color is something they're not shy about showing off. However, not everyone is such a huge fan of SDA week. In fact, some hate it and are very open about sharing their opinions. And so a question arises: why do people hate SDA? I took to the Wayne Valley hallways to find out what all the controversy is about.
What's your opinion on SDA?
I think it's fun to watch. I don't know.
What's the word? It's just like too extra.
I like SDA because it's a club and anyone can join.
My opinion on SDA is a positive one. I think the young ladies do a great job. It involves team play, being innovative.
I love SDA, my favorite thing in the world. Do you think all the screaming is annoying?
Well, at my age, I would say yes, it is.
I love it, and I love being a captain.
It's a fun way to bring everyone together.
I love it because I like teaching the girls how to dance.
Hate it. It's the worst time of the year.
It's my favorite time of year. I get so excited. I love all of it.
It's fun. SDA is pretty awesome.
This is terrifying.
I think it's a really good experience. You're walking through the hallway at SDA Monday and everyone's screaming. What's going through your mind?
Oh, I hate it so much.
Well, usually I'm just like, why am I here?
I wish I never woke up this morning.
I'll scream louder to assert dominance.
I just want them all to stop.
I don't like it.
I want to go home and I hate everybody.
I'm going back in the car. I can't take this anymore.
Get the hell out of my face.
Have a good rest of your day.
Whether you love it or hate it, SDA is a tradition that will stick around for a while. Despite any reaction from the public, the girls of blue and white will continue to scream and chant for their color for many seasons to come.
I totally agree with everyone who thinks SDA is horrible.
Oh yeah, I definitely believe that.
Valentine,
time to get serious. Students, teachers, administrators, Allie and I are here to welcome you to the 96th day of school. Today we'll be honoring Hollywood's, Wayne Valley's best and brightest.
We're not actually talking about the Oscars, but instead we're talking about something very close, the talent show.
On February 1st, many gifted students took the stage and performed their hearts out in front of millions.
Okay, not millions, but many parents and students came out to watch their children and classmates showcase their talents.
And the winner was Sarah Chernyshuk. She received a $50 card and respect from our country.
Seriously, Madison, we're not talking about the Oscars anymore.
You're right. We're talking about the 14th annual Poetry Out Loud competition.
Tons of students became poets for the day and read in front of their English teachers who acted as judges.
And the winner was Junior Erin Matthews. She was chosen to travel to Bergen County Community College to compete with other high schoolers around the region.
There has been so many competitions lately. Maybe Wayne Valley should host something that brings the school together.
They are. Kindness Week is next week.
Oh, you're right. I could think of a really, really good kind gesture. Parking in the correct spot.
So true. I feel like a lot of students needed to be reminded of that.
Here's Christina with a parking PSA on where to park and where to not.
Parking in the correct spot seems like an easy task, but for some students, it's a challenge. Exhibit A. Here we are with the friendly SRO talking about the library parking situation.
You cannot park in front of the municipal building, even all the way over by the library. Why? It's very simple. The place is under construction and they need the area for construction trucks and contractor parking. So if you do not obey, you're going to get a ticket and then you're going to cry and then your mother and father are going to have to pay for it. So good luck. We're all counting on you.
Exhibit B.
Parked in my spot, so now I have to take someone else's.
Exhibit C.
Child development. Why is someone in my spot?
That really needed to be said.
I agree. You know what else needs to be said?
I don't know. My Oscar acceptance speech?
Not quite. I think a student should compliment our teachers for all their hard work, just like how some people write anonymous reviews on ratemyteachers.com.
The school news team was inspired by Kindness Week to go around and have teachers read some nice reviews.
Mr. Karsich is my favorite gym teacher, the phys ed teacher.
Dee is an amazing teacher and very helpful all the time. She also is very fun to talk to and have as a teacher. It's really nice.
Do they have a counselor of the year? She should be it.
Wow!
My favorite teacher I ever had in high school. Was lucky enough to have him for biology and anatomy. Oh, that's so great.
Those who claim not to love Shemley are not to be trusted.
I suck at math, but this goddess pulled me out of the rut and taught me how to factor like nobody could.
Mr. Flower is one of the coolest teachers in the world. He is the man, easiest and funniest class ever. He's the man. Yeah, I spelled some things wrong in that one.
He understands if you suck at gym and will work with you to keep you from failing. I feel very good about myself right now.
Good.
Thank you very much, that was very nice.
Carol is godly. If you disagree, remember, education isn't for everybody.
I am the best Spanish teacher there is, hands down. I'm also the best very nice to look at.
Mr. Yale is the bomb diggity.
Amazing teacher, very knowledgeable, as well as helpful throughout the entire year. That's really sweet. I mean, I do try my best.
Mi madre, ella fue muy buena y simpática.
Very nice guy, but talks a lot. I guess so. I'm not talking a lot right now, but I can keep talking if you want me to.
She's a very good teacher and cares about the students and where they're going in life.
Aw, that's nice.
She's the nicest and one of the funniest teachers I ever had.
You have a problem with her, you'll need a mirror to find it. Best guidance ever. Wow, I'm very flattered.
She'll always help you if you're struggling in something. Great teacher and super funny.
Some of those were pretty interesting, but really sweet.
The viewers will have to stay tuned on our channel to see teachers reading their not-so-nice reviews.
Well, our time has come to an end, and I would just like to say that it's been my privilege. I'd like to thank everyone for watching. I'd like to thank the Academy.
Okay, that's not even the right award show, so I'm gonna stop you there. But the Oscar goes to the Man on the Street team for wanting to know what you're doing February 29th. Thanks for watching.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed. She was looking kind of dumb with her finger and her thumb in the shape of an L on her forehead.
What do you think, I'm stupid or something? February 29th doesn't exist.
When is that? Nothing. Is this a leap year? I have no idea.
It's not a leap year.
I don't know.
Why? You just tell me the answer?
No.
I mean, probably like going out to eat and like hanging out with people.
That's not real.
There is no February 29th.
There is not a February 29th every 4 years.
She just said there's not a leap year.
This year.
It's a leap year.
I'm not doing anything.
Probably play some leapfrog because it's leap year.
It's not this year.
No, it really?
February 29th does not happen in 2019.
Oh my god. Oh my god. It's a nightmare.
There's no February 29th.
I don't think there's one this year. Maybe other years? Isn't that like a leap year? Like. Leap year.
On February 29th, depending on if it's leap year or not, I don't know if this is leap year, but if it is, I hope to be alive. That's what I hope to be breathing.
So what are you doing February 29th?
What do you mean? I thought we were hanging out that day.
Yeah, we would if it was the leap year, but it's not.
I feel stupid.
You know who's not stupid? AP students.
Here's Jada with the story.
Advanced placement classes, the double-edged sword that plagues the hallowed halls of almost every high school. Everyone at Valley has that one friend who constantly talks about their AP workload. It's usually a surplus of complaints about how the AP Gov test is going to kill my grade, or how AP US History is going to bring my 4.0 to a 3.9. AP students can be very vocal about all the work and all the stress that comes along with these classes. So this made me wonder, why do they choose to put themselves through all that misery?
But the stress is worth it if you're getting the GPA booster, and especially like if you're learning the material before you go to college, because then you're just going to have a less stressful college experience.
An AP student experiences the perks of classes firsthand. It's a GPA booster and definitely helps with college acceptances. However, if a student does poorly in these classes, it can be detrimental to their GPA.
I do know it. The grades that you get in the classes really matter. So if you're going to take 7 APs and you're not going to do well in any of them, that's not going to help.
The students who don't take AP classes seem to get annoyed with the AP students who constantly talk about all of their classes.
I only find it annoying because they use all the stupid little initials. Like, just say you're going to environmental. You don't have to say you're going to apes. Like, it's so much, and people get your point across a lot easier if you just say the name of the actual class. Like, don't say you're going to APQURST, say you're going to math. You know? I don't need that. You know?
It became clear that taking an AP class can help you in life, but not taking an AP class won't necessarily affect you in a negative way. And remember, if you choose to take a hard class like 8 Push, please be mindful of those around you and keep complaints to a minimum. You've made your AP bed, now it's time to lie in it.
Wayne. Don't catch you slipping now.
what I'm whipping up. This is America. Don't catch you slipping up. Don't catch you slipping up.
Hi, I'm Jada.
And I'm Joseph. Welcome to community. Jada, why are you a magician? I thought our theme was President's Day.
Joe, I'm Abraham Lincoln. Who did that to your hair?
I'm just testing it out. I showed my barber this picture.
It's a look. Anyway, 41 months ago, we visited the chocolate expo at the Garden State Plaza. Other than eating loads of chocolate and nearly putting ourselves into food comas, we got to see many actors from famous chocolate-related movies. And we got to see the car from Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. At the end of the day, we would highly recommend visiting the next time you're in town.
That was so much fun, but we really should have ate something healthier.
I stopped being vegan like a month ago. I wanted to stay vegan, but I caved as soon as I saw the chocolate.
Now you're making me hungry. I've really been craving a smoothie bowl lately.
But where to choose from after the rivalry of sweet berry bowls and playa bowls?
Mac, can you go find out which bowl is better?
In Wayne's history, there have been many food rivalries, from frozen yogurt to bagel straps. The newest rivalry has arrived in its fruit bowls. Recently, the co-owner of Playa Bowls has split and made their own business, Sweetberry Bowls. With locations now in Wayne, Little Falls, and Glen Rock, it's fair to say that they're a food chain on the rise. So what's the difference? Well, the prices are pretty much the same, so that made our choices even more difficult. For one, the menus have changed. Berry Bowls offers wraps and other healthy choices like salads. The atmosphere is different too. Sweetberry Bowls has branched off from the beach-like look that Playa has become so famous for, and went for something much more tropical. We brought some of our friends to sample the different bowls that each store had to offer. Though they may look the same, they certainly tasted different, and both had delicious smoothies for us to try. The bowls are usually made of some blend of frozen acai berry and cut-up fruit with a layer of granola and your favorite topping, such as Nutella, coconut, honey, almond butter, and more. We would contend, no matter where you go, you'll be impressed with the bowl you get. So, will this just be another food fad, or are these bowls here to stay?
Well, this is awkward.
Jada, how could you?
Whatever, George. I'm still hungry, though. Where am I supposed to go now?
You could go to Chuck E. Cheese and get a pizza.
Joe, is that wig a little too tight? You should definitely get that checked out.
Speaking of checking things out, I cannot wait for the new Whole Foods to open across the street from Valley.
Wasn't an organic food market supposed to go there?
Yes. Originally, an organic food market was moving in across the street. They had begun renovating on the property, but due to rental disputes, they decided to pull out, leaving the space vacant again, and with no new businesses in sight. Recently, the American supermarket chain, Whole Foods, has decided to move into the space. They plan to expand their square footage into the vacant Subway space as well. This will be the first new store to open since AMP went out of business nearly 4 years ago. Finally, students who decide to trek across the street for lunch will have a new place to go to and buy a quick bite to eat while still remaining healthy.
Well, I heard it's still going to be a few years away from now.
That's right. I guess we'll never get to walk across the street and get you that healthy snack after all. Jada, what are you doing?
Nothing.
Let's make a new minute to win a challenge. You have a minute to finish that bowl, otherwise you lose.
Joe, I'm not doing any of your dumb minute to win it challenges.
Well, Matt was willing to, and he shows us the best and worst minute to win it skills Wayne Valley has to offer.
And Madison will spill the lunchroom tea.
Until next time, I'm Joseph.
And I'm Jada. We'll see you on the other side of the war.
Go the distance. In this challenge, a measuring tape will be used as a bridge to roll three ping pong balls into three awaiting shot glasses. Too steep an angle and the balls will fly past the target. The contestant must deposit a ball at distances of 5, 6, and 7 feet. Failure to complete this task in 60 seconds may result in elimination. The game begins in 3, 2, 1.
Oh, you can't do that.
Oh, come on.
It doesn't...
Hi, I'm Madison Indominico, and I'm here to bring light to something that's been happening since the beginning of time. Here at Wayne Valley, the lunchroom is a place where students go to enjoy the chocolate chip cookies and chat with friends, unless you're a freshman. So now we're going deep into the woods of the freshman cafeteria. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know if I'm going to make it out alive, but guess what? I'm going in for you, Wayne Valley. Why do you have a speaker?
We got a bump at lunch, you know?
Or enjoy the delectable food in the bathroom. Besides that, it seems to be a place of sanctuary for many, despite the scarce quarrels that pop up. Our generation had a very extravagant view of high school and their cafeterias prior to their enrollment. You may ask, what makes people think that the lunchroom is a place to walk on eggshells and to keep to yourself in fear of aggression? What gives the expectation of drama? The answer has been in our AirPods and on our screens the whole time. Movies, like the infamous Mean Girls, portray the cafeteria as a place where bullies thrive and girl fights transpire. Even from movies as early as time, like Flip's Lunchroom in 1933. But what really shaped our perception of the lunchroom are the sensational, action-packed scenes from our most beloved childhood movies. Some classics include Sky High, which shows high school superheroes fighting to the death over, literally, spilled milk. They very clearly depict the divide between the upper class and the lower class. The reality of these movies have been up to speculation, but I think that their depiction of lunchroom bullies are very convoluted and miss the target on the actual perpetrator. What if I told you that all of the students from the QB1 to the valedictorian to the SoundCloud rapper have a common enemy? Some students don't notice, and other students are annoyed, but either way, it's a common occurrence in the lunchroom for teachers to cut students in the lunch line. I took to the halls of Wayne Valley to find some answers on why teachers might cut the students and how they feel about it. Are you aware that some teachers cut the students in line?
I am not.
Are you one of those people?
I am not one of those people.
Are you lying to me?
I am not lying to you.
Are you sure?
100%.
Maybe they feel entitled to do so.
Why do you think they feel entitled?
Because they're teachers and they're superiors to the kids.
You think that the teachers are superior to the kids?
Did you just trick me with that question?
Yeah. I don't know, did I?
It seems like it.
So you think that the teachers should be able to cut the students in the cafeteria line?
Absolutely not.
You're contradicting what you say a little bit.
Am I though? I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't think so. I think I'm sticking to it.
So you think that the students and the teachers are equal in the cafeteria?
In the cafeteria line, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Like, this one's gonna come back to haunt me.
Have you ever eaten lunch from the cafeteria?
Yes.
Have you ever cut a student in line in the cafeteria?
Yes.
Why?
Because I want to.
Do you feel superior to the students?
In that instance, it would appear I do.
How come?
That's a good question. Because I'm old and I've earned it. But I say thank you.
I don't remember you saying thank you to me when you cut me in line last year.
Did I tell you I did? Was I like, I usually say I'm going to cut you.
No.
I don't apologize for cutting you. I would still do that, but I apologize that I didn't say something.
I accept your apology.
Thank you.
If I wasn't pressed for time, I would always like wait in line just like everybody else.
What if I'm also pressed for time?
Well, that's your tough luck.
Well, what if I say that's your tough luck?
No, I'm bigger than you are.
Well, I'm taller.
Okay, I give up.
Ladies and gentlemen,
so hard to find.
We got him.
So if you're watching this and you're a teacher, next time, maybe ask the students if you could pass them in line. Communication is key. And if you're watching this and you're a student, let them pass, because we're all fighting our own battles.
Who knew that teachers were the problem in lunch lines?
At least that's over for us since we get to go out.
Yeah, I go out and buy lunch every day. My New Year's resolution was to save money, but it's not working out.
I bet our students and staff have some pretty interesting resolutions. Let's see what they're planning to change for the new year.
To get into better shape.
Drop it, give me 5 push-ups.
No.
Be the best man I can be.
Can you compliment Jada for us? Jada,
can I? Sure. You are a great friend, Jada.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
What a good friend.
Go to the gym, yeah, like every day. Like,
you know, I would really piss off. Can you do 10 sit-ups for us?
Like a lot.
No.
Oh my
God. To lose weight.
Same thing.
Drop and give me 5.
Oh, oh no!
Ready?
1.
Oh, I can't
2.
Do it.
3.
4.
Okay.
That's embarrassing.
I mean, probably not to be rude, but it's not really working, so.
Say something nice to me.
No.
To be more fit this year.
Can you do 5 push-ups for me?
Yes.
All right, let's go. 5. Go to 10, go to 10. All right, go to 50.
To actually stick to them.
But what's your resolution?
I don't know.
Can you make up one right now?
No.
Block out all the negativity in my life and be fit. I don't know.
Can you do 10 push-ups for me right now?
Yes. Watch out. I got this.
Let's go.
Ready?
Pump 1, that iron.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. She's fit.
Oh my God.
She's fit.
To stop being a vegetarian.
Do well in school and be happy.
Oh, my New Year's resolution? It's just to open my mind, expand my horizons, my mental horizons. That's what I want to do this year.
Welcome back to the February edition of V Sports. I'm Sammy Holman.
And I'm Kevin Schneeluck. We're broadcasting live from Super Bowl 53, and if you haven't noticed, Sammy and I are furious.
For once, I agree with Kevin. We both believe that the Patriots should not have made the Super Bowl.
So in protest, we are wearing our Giants jerseys.
Yep, that's right. We could talk about how much we hate the Patriots all day, but we want to update you on the latest in Lehigh Valley Winter Athletics.
The boys' basketball team, with a current record of 12-4, have secured the number 1 seed in the upcoming county tournament. They also took first place in the J.P. Flynn Invitational Holiday Tournament, beating Mendham in the final. Congrats to senior guard Mark Howell on scoring his 1,000th point against West Milford.
The girls' basketball team has a current record of 13-3 and also secured the number 1 seed in the county tournament. Senior Stephanie LaGreca and junior Brianna Neary led the team as they look to improve even more with the return of senior Carson Thomas from injury.
The boys' fencing team is having a historical second season with the help of junior Will Michaels, sophomore Zach Janelk, and seniors Ryan Lim, Ryan Farlie, and Tyler Maines. Revenge wins over PV, Pompton Lakes, and Butler have helped the boys' team increase their win total from 1-5 this year. Congratulations to the boys on a remarkable season, and congrats to Coach Tam on the new addition to the team.
The girls' swim team has a current record of 7-3. They placed second in the counties and won the 200 free relay and secured a spot in the media champs. Congrats to Claire Customs, Madison Barwinski, Emily Valenzuela, and Grace Sendak.
The boys' swim team has a current record of 4-6. Seniors Brian Borchard and Josh Salone lead the team to a second place in the county tournament. Freshman Michael Matthews has also helped the boys this season with their victories.
Wait, Kevin, stop talking. The halftime show is starting.
But Sam, we have to finish. Wait, is that our sports producer, Frank Pettorini?
Oh my God, it is.
All right, baby. All
was amazing.
Best thing I've seen all game. The wrestling team has been off to an amazing start with a record of 15-4. Captains Reed Colella, Nick Chani, Dan Murphy, and Nick Duncan have high aspirations to reach the state championships at Boardwalk Hall in Atlantic City. Congrats to Reed Colella, Nick Chani, and Elijah Lugo on being crowned county champions.
The winter track team also had a dream season. Led by seniors Julia Philp and Shannon DeCristina, the team has been crowned conference champions. Congrats to the 4x4 team on winning the county championship. The girls' fencing team, currently with a record of 5-6, have seen enormous contributions from their seniors Maggie Olea, Emily Carvalho, and Ashley McDermott, all leading the team in wins. That's all for this edition of eSports.
And hopefully the Patriots don't win any more championships.
If you're an athlete here at Valley, I'm sure you can agree that continuing to play in college would be an incredible opportunity. Unfortunately, for many, high school athletics is the end of the road, but a select few are given the chance to play at the next level. As teenagers are already balancing schoolwork, a social life, and a close relationship with family, communicating with coaches and preparing film keeps these student athletes very busy. The process begins when the athletes make contact with their first coach about possibly playing for their school. Some are in contact with the coaches by freshman year, while others don't get the chance until junior or senior year. Although, by NCAA rule, coaches cannot contact the recruits by phone or in person until July 1st following their junior year. Even past this point, coaches are typically only allowed one or two phone calls per week. During this time, the recruits are attending camps, visiting campuses, and working with their high school coach, all in order to impress the college coaches.
Were some coaches able to persuade you better than other coaches?
Yeah, some coaches can be kind of cold, and others are really welcoming and want you to come on the squad.
Definitely. If you kept good contact and stuff, it was definitely a bigger factor than guys that just kind of emailed me once or twice.
For each athlete, a lot of factors will go into their final decision, including if they even want to play the sport, distance from home, and success of the team. Leaving home to go into a new environment is hard enough without having to balance a sports team on top of academics. Transitioning to play at the next level requires the athletes to grow physically and mentally. Unlike in high school, each player takes on more responsibility with their parents no longer around. They are expected to be top-notch students who make the right decision while keeping in good shape.
When deciding where to play in college, what were the most important factors for you?
Definitely the location and the academics.
Honestly, like where it was, because I wasn't looking for like a big school with 50,000 people. Like I'm going to a small school and I didn't want to just be a face. I wanted to be known around the school.
When the time comes for current high school athletes to begin their first college season, the thought of playing against grown men and women becomes a reality. As freshmen, players will be forced to work extra hard to prove themselves to the staff since they don't have the experience of the other players. College athletics are a great way to allow graduating high school students to pursue a further education for a fraction of the cost, if any. It also allows kids to get into better schools that they may not have been able to get into without athletics. The fortunate 2% of high school athletes that receive a scholarship to play in college must work to the best of their ability day in and day out to improve their position on the team. After college, it is also possible for the best of the best to play at the professional level.
With the first pick in the 2018 NFL Draft, the Cleveland Browns select Baker Mayfield.
Wayne Valley has seen numerous athletes go off to play at Division 1, 2, and 3 schools in the past few years. Some of these schools include Bucknell, Lafayette, and Drexel. Good luck to all the athletes on the rest of their seasons and on the college recruiting process.
Thank you for tuning in to this month's episode of The V. We hope you all enjoyed and stay tuned for more videos.
Be sure to like and subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow Ms. Damer on Twitter for updates on all things Wayne Valley TV.
Before you go, we have Daniel Bernstein showing incredible magic tricks. You won't believe your eyes.
Projector gets up.
All right, while we're setting the tech up, I'm actually going to need a volunteer for this. So, front row. Your name?
Brianna.
All right, Brianna. Can we give Brianna a nice round of applause? Yeah. Okay, so in a moment, Brianna, we're going to tell a story together. But before we do, we need to establish the magical connection or whatever. So here's what we're going to do. I have two magic rings here. You have a preference? Okay, good. Open your hand up, perfect. And you just hold that in your fist like that, and just like stand like right there, like you know, like face to face down. Perfect. Now in a second, what we're going to do is this. I'm holding mine too. You're going to give me a little fist bump, and we're going to share a thought. You're going to, as soon as I, you know, bump your fist, you're going to name a card, the first one that pops into your mind. Does that make sense? Perfect. A spade seven. A spade. Okay, perfect. Yeah. You said eight spades, and I said seven, correct? Okay. In this deck, there are three cards. We got it? Perfect. Just in time. You said what card again? Ace of spades. I said seven. One, two, three, four, five, six. Ace of spades. So I think it's a nice little warm up. So now we're gonna get into something a little bit different. Brianna, right? Now, do you like movies? And I assume you've seen a movie where there's like a flashback or something like that, right? A story that's told out of order. We're going to do that right now with the cards. We're going to tell a story out of order. And a number of scenes that may or may not occur in the order that they appear. So, does it make sense? It'll be clear by the end of it, sure. So basically, I'm going to do a number of scenes. Scene one, in which I introduce you. Come to the notebook. Scene four. Red back game. Now notice, by the way, that I said red back, as opposed to the blue back cards we're going to be using for the rest of the deck, for the rest of the 13. I'll put the rest of the red deck away. We don't need that for the rest of the deck. Now, scene two, in which I take a mystery card out of the deck, build a little suspense. That's the great thing about stories told out of order is there's this idea of a suspense and intrigue you can't get in normal storytelling. So I'm going to take a single card out, and you can't see this card. It's important that you can't see that card. Perfect. And you're going to remember later that I took one card out that you had no idea what it was, and that I took it and I put it face up and face down in a face up deck. And you can see it at the beginning. You can see that card face down in a face up deck, correct? Perfect. Now. Scene three is where you come in. I'm gonna cut through these decks, these cards. I'm gonna peel off cards in a moment, okay? And when I peel off cards, all I need you to do is simply, as I go through, you just say stop. Here? The two of hearts, right? Perfect. I have, right here, a Sharpie. Can you please take that and sign that two of hearts with your own double signature, like right there? All right, and that? Okay. That's yours, right? Everybody can see that?
Yes.
Perfect. That's fine. All right, perfect. And I just want to make sure that's yours. And I'm not fooling you at all. Perfect. I'm going to put this right here. I'm going to put these aside. Now, I know things have gotten a little bit complicated, but scene four is where everything comes together. I'm going to take your card and place it in between four majestic red back chains. And you can see in the middle, until the very end. But that, everybody, is when something truly amazing occurs. Call it a shift in time, whatever you will. It's almost as if now that card is gone. Because that's a king. And you'll verify for me that is just the four kings, right? Remember in the beginning, Brianna, When I showed you a mystery card and I made a whole silly thing about it, but I put one card for almost anything else face down in a face up deck. And that certainly occurred before almost everything else. Certainly before you chose, of your own free will, the Two of Hearts, and signed it with your own unique, indelible signature, correct? Or at least, that would be how it seems. But if I were to look right here, there's one face-up card, face-up deck. One more thing. Because every good movie, every good story, has an even better script. You chose that of your own free will, right? I didn't consult with you before. And yet, I have a script on me, actually. It's a single piece of paper. It's very small. I don't work with a very large script. But if you do me a favor, just open that up and read that to everybody.
You will take the Two of Hearts.
I just want to show that to everybody. Thank you.